makes you anxious. It makes you miserable. But as a child of God, what we must understand is that God is doing something. Because you can't, God may put you in a situation where you have to depend on your flaw, your weakness, on your lack, because you can't parade your weakness. I'm going to say that again. When God puts you in situations where you can't use those abilities and those skill sets and those talents, and you are asked to draw from your weakness and your lack, what God is doing is God is helping you to strengthen the weaknesses. You can't parade your weaknesses. Nobody wants to parade their weaknesses. As a matter of fact, nobody wants anybody to know what their weaknesses are. Nobody wants anybody to know what their lacks are. Nobody wants anybody to know what their flaws are. We always want people to know what our gifts are. We want people to know what our strengths are. But we don't want anybody to know what our weaknesses are. And so sometimes you are placed in situations where you can't parade your weaknesses. As a matter of fact, nobody wants anybody to know what their weaknesses are. But when God allows you in certain situations, God is working on you. When God allows you to be in a situation where you can't use your gifts, abilities, and talents, and you have to draw from your weaknesses and your flaws and your lacks, God is working on you. God will give you a job that you're not equipped for just to equip you for it. I'm going to say that again. God will give you a job that you are not equipped for simply to equip you. God doesn't always call the qualified, but he qualifies those who he calls. Now the challenge that Gideon is having, look at the challenge that Gideon is having. Gideon is a judge, and his responsibility is to deliver the people when they are in trouble. That's what his job is. He's a judge. He's not come down to pass sentence like we know that a judge will ask the jury what is their verdict, and they would then pronounce the verdict. That's not what the judge is in the book of Judges. In the book of Judges, the judge has the responsibility to deliver God's people when they are in trouble. Every time the people turn from God and turn their own way and they find themselves in trouble, they are to turn to the judge, and the judge will deliver them. The judge is to have total trust in God, and by his example, point to people to God. But here is the dilemma that Gideon is having. He has a problem trusting God. So God allows a problem because he has a problem. God gives him a problem because he has a problem. He has 120,000 men that are standing against him, and he only has 32,000 men. So there are 120,000 men who are waiting to destroy all of Israel, and he only has 32,000 men. That is a problem. You know why God, now you have to understand why God allowed problems to face us just about any time. Let me ask you, because you look dazed, you look like you're in a daze. So let me ask you a question. Anybody here has watched the latest X-Men? Anybody watch the latest X-Men? Only the young people, only one person has watched, young men. Y'all don't watch movies inside here. Two queer persons have watched the latest. You're not into sci-fi kind of stuff?
Broke.
No?
Money. It's on a list.
Broke on money's on a list. Y'all got here. need money to get to go watch the Lakers X-Men. Okay. Well, this is the concept of the latest X-Men. The concept is, it's called X-Men Days of Future Past. And what the X-Men are doing, you haven't seen it, Kevin? You haven't seen the latest X-Men? Have you seen the concept? Man, you guys don't watch movies, you guys have other things to do, right? Well, the concept is they are in the future. They're in the present, right? They're in the present. And these are mutants. It's hard to explain it to you if you have not watched it. These guys are mutants, and they have created machines that are able to kill the X-Men. Now, the X-Men, these are guys who have all different kinds of powers. Guys can freeze guys can spew fire, guys can look through things, guys can read minds. They're just humans with super ordinary powers. So they develop this machine that can actually kill them. But they're in the present. Now they say the only way that we can stop these machines called the Sentinels from destroying us, we have to go back in the past. So they lay this guy called Wolverine down. This guy, have you seen this guy with the iron comes out of his hand? Maybe you've seen him. So this guy lies down, and he lies down, and they bring him back into the past. Now, when they bring him back into the past, he goes back into the past knowing everything. He's just walking around. He's talking to his enemies, and his enemies are like, how are you talking to me? We're enemies. But he is coming from the future. And because he's coming from the future, he knows what happened in the future, and he knows that they became friends in the future, so he's just talking around, but they're at a different place. They're at this place where they're still thinking that they're enemies, but he comes back from the future. He's now in the past, and he's just saying, we're buddies, we can be friends, we can be all of this, and there's a little clash going on there. He's just walking around, cozying around, having a grand time, because he's coming from the future, and he knows everything that is happening in the future. And so when we look at God and we are frustrated about things that are happening in our present, we have to understand, this concept just came to me as I was watching. We have to understand that while we're all troubled and fired up about what is going on, God is already in the future. And he understands that everything is going to be worked out and everything is going to be all right. So when we are worked up and we want God to move and we want God to, God is just having a grand old time. God is just moving at his own sweet pace because he knows what's going to happen in the future. It is in this context that the Bible says that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, that he's already in the future, and his future, he knows everything. Amen. You're right where you are, and he knows what's going to happen tomorrow, because he's already there. He's already in tomorrow. And so he can create any problem, because he can fix any problem, because he already knows how it's going to be played out. Because while you're right where you are, stressed out about what is going on now, we must remember that our present is God's past. So we're stressed out about our present, but while we're stressed out about our present, it is God's past. God knows what's going to happen. Your future is God's past. You know, that concept is too big. Your future, Irene, 10 years down the line is God's past. God knows what's going to happen 10 years from now. And he knew that 10 million years ago. That's who he is. And so when he creates any kind of problem or allows us to go into any kind of problem, he knows exactly how it's going to be played out. 120 enemies against 32,000, that's a ratio of 12 to 1. Every 12 enemy is only one man. And that's what he has. He's banking on that. He has 120,000 people, Courtney, who he has to face. Gideon has 120,000 enemies, and he only has 32,000. That's a ratio of 12 to 1. If you go into war on a scale of 12 to 1, you are expected to be destroyed. Because every one man has 12 men coming at him. That's something. And if those men who died from the 32,000, it makes the ratio even worse. So he goes into battle with 32,000, and there's 120,000 who he has to face. And even with that ratio, God tells him that that's too much. Now that's a big thing for him, because he doesn't trust God in the first place. And now he has 12,000 men with 32,000 men, and God is telling him that he has too many men. God tells him, anybody who is afraid and trembling, send them home. And if you see 120,000 men and you are in an army with 32,000 men, I'm telling you, you're going to be afraid. So you got a whole lot of guys who are afraid. Actually, you got 22,000 men who are afraid. And after that, you only have 10,000 men left. So he has 10,000 men left, and he has 120,000 men who he has to face. You see what God is doing to this poor man? Gideon's weakness is trusting God. And God is pulling on his weakness by taking away all his strength. That's big. Have you ever been in a situation where the odds were against you and the little help you had depending on departed from you? Have you ever been in a situation where you only have a few friends left? And the few friends who you have left, they departed and left you all alone. Have you ever been in a situation where you had just a little money left? Oh, well. And the little money that you're depending on, it all gets used up. Have you ever been in a situation where your spouse should have been by your side through the thick and thin? You expected them to be there. But now that you find yourself in a situation, they depart and leave you alone. This is what Gideon is going through. Take your 10,000. The ratio would be 12 to 1. And now, when God takes you to the river, like he takes Gideon to the river, he's taking Gideon to the river to downsize him. But the challenge is, Gideon is already down. When God takes us to the river to downsize us, when we are already down, it can be a devastating thing to most people. When life takes you to that place where you're down and out and you have nothing left, the little you have left is then taken away. It can blow your mind. It can kill you. God's place of separation is the place of questioning. Where you are there questioning God. Your question is, how much are you going to give? How much? Your question is, how much are you going to take, Lord? And God's question is, how much is it going to take you? So he brought the people down to the water. The Lord said to Gideon, you shall separate everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, and as well as everyone who kneels to drink. Now the number of those who lapped, putting their hand to their mouth, was 300 men. But all the rest of the people kneel to drink water. God is working on Gideon. He knows he has a problem trusting. He puts him in the situation where it requires total trust. Now he has 120,000 enemies and he only has 300 men. That's a ratio of 400 to 1. Every one soldier, he has 120, every one soldier, he has 400 enemies to deal with. That's a big thing. God chose the 300 whose eyes were on the battle as long as they were drinking. Anybody else or anything else would have been a hindrance to the plan of God. And sometimes the things that God takes away from us at the river are things that are going to be a hindrance to us in the plan of salvation. Sometimes God is going to take you to that separating place. That place of separation is a place where God is separating from you everything and anything that you don't need to accomplish his plan. The challenge we have is that we don't always know what God's plan is. And because we don't always know what God's plan is, when the things that are being taken away from us, we think it's all good for us. But God is working on us. The things that God separates from us are the things that will be a hindrance to us accomplishing the plan of God. I'm going to say it again. The things that God removed from our lives are the things that are a hindrance to the plan of God. I'm going to say it again. The things that God removes from us are things that are a hindrance to the plan of God. We don't understand what the plan of God is. And because we do not know what the plan of God is, when God is taken away from us, we don't know what God is doing. But God, when he takes stuff from us, he's not just willy-nilly just walking, taking stuff because God has nothing to do. God knows the destination that he has for us. God knows the plan that he has for us. God knows the job that he has for us. And in order to accomplish the job, God must remove the things that are hindrances to our lives. If Gideon went to the battle with 32,000 men, it would be 32,000 men fighting against 120,000 men. But God said 300. Because the problem he was having was trusting God. And now that he had the chance to trust in the numbers that he had, God took away the numbers. And every time that we walk with God and we are going to put our trust in something else but God, the pastor and the word of God is here today to let you know that God will have no problem to remove it from our lives. God will take us to that place of separation. We do not know what the plan of God necessarily is in full, but God has a design for your life. The Bible says before you were born in your mother's womb, God had a plan for your life. And as you went on in this life and in this journey, you developed some habits that God will have to break in order for us to accomplish the plan that God has for us. Some of us, it's material things that we have attached ourselves to that God will have to take away. Some of us, it's relationships that we have attached ourselves to that we put our trust in that God will have to break in order for us to accomplish the plan of God in our lives. The 300 men divided themselves into three groups and they surrounded the camp. And the Bible says with their torches and their pitchers, they stood at the place where they are to stand. Because when God is working on you and preparing you for whatever he has for you to accomplish, God is going to fight the battle all by himself.
Amen.
God has separated everything from you so you can't depend on anything that you don't need to depend on. So that you can have freeness to depend on him.
Amen.
Because he has a plan to fight the battle for you. And so he brought these men, as I close, he brought them to the place where the battle was and divided 300 men, and they surrounded the camp, 100 on each side. And when these men started to shout, sword for the Lord and a sword for Gideon, the Bible says that confusion hit the camp. And every man who was in the camp, 120 men strong, they started to fight each other. And they started to kill each other. And the battle was over. The rest who were left, Gideon and his men, they hunted them, because the battle is not yours. When God is working on you, God has a plan for you. And when God has a plan for you, you don't need to work this plan. You need to trust God. And if you have a problem or a weakness or a lack, God is going to put you in a situation where you have to draw from your weakness, draw from your lack, and draw from your flaw in order to accomplish what God has. He's not going to give you those abilities and strengths that you have to work. He's going to use your weaknesses, because he has to develop them. He's going to use your flaws, because he has to melt them and break them and mold them. Because God, ultimately, Courtney, God is trying to develop his character in all of us.
Amen.
So that we will be ready when he comes. Today, I don't know about you, but I want God to continue to work on me. I don't know about you, but even if I'm placed in situations where God is calling upon me, and the weaknesses that are in me, and the flaws that are in me, people are at a place where they don't want nobody to know what's going on. Nobody wants to be vulnerable. But let me be honest with you. If you are going to make it into the kingdom of God, you have to become vulnerable before God. In those situations where your weaknesses are called upon to win the battle, the devil will use them to expose your weaknesses. He will. If he gets the opportunity to expose you, he will expose you. If he gets the opportunity to destroy you, he will destroy you. He knows your weaknesses, and he will play on those weaknesses. He will give you all that you need to destroy yourself using those weaknesses. But God is merciful. God sees them, and he knows them, and he knows that with these weaknesses in me, I may be impatient. You know what he's going to do? He's going to give me something for me to learn patience. That's crazy, Kelly. Because God is in the business of building you, not tearing you down. When God sees your weaknesses, Violet, he